Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. Today, physicist Eugene Bagashov continues his analysis of the scientific missions to the asteroids Bennu and Ryugu, respectively. As Eugene explained in the previous episode, one of the hypotheses scientists have proposed to explain a number of asteroid anomalies is that many asteroids are essentially, quote, rubble piles. In fact, when asteroids have occasionally displayed dramatic and completely unexpected comet-like tails, the explanation astronomers have offered is that the so-called rubble piles simply began spinning faster and faster, hurling material into space. However, as Eugene explains as he continues his discussion, the latest scientific data offers little support for the rubble pile asteroid hypothesis.
Let us now talk about the other issue, that is the spin of these asteroids. Currently, Ryugu has a spin period of 7.63 hours and Bennu of 4.29 hours. But here the interesting stuff begins. One thing that the researchers from Hayabusa 2 mission keep referring to is the hypothetical long-term trend in slowing down of the spin of Ryugu. In that way, they are able to more or less explain on the basis of the rubble pile model the surface slopes of the asteroid and also the distribution of boulders on its surface. And they attribute this hypothetical spinning down to the so-called Yarkovsky-O'Keefe-Radziyevsky-Paddock effect, or YORP. This effect basically implies that the irregular form of the asteroid leads to the imbalance in its thermal emission in different directions, which in turn causes the object to experience some very small torque. And on long timescales, it might alter the rotational period quite a bit, introduce tilting of the spin axis, wobbling, and other things like that. Well, okay, perhaps, but let us look at Bennu now. Here we see not the hypothetical, but actually observed spinning up of the asteroid. It has been derived from a series of ground-based observations, the earliest one being made in 1999, and now confirmed by the OSIRIS-REx data. Bennu is spinning faster and faster, losing about a second of spin period each century. That would mean that the doubling of the spin rate would happen in only 1.5 million years, and the rubble pile model used by the researchers in OSIRIS-REx team predicts that it would be incompatible with the stability of the asteroid. At this rate of spinning up, it should have been torn apart by centrifugal forces very long time ago. Perhaps the reasonable conclusion that should follow from that is that the body should be much younger than even 10 million years. But the researchers are obviously not happy with that conclusion, so to somehow cope with this, they invoke additional and not very plausible assumptions, such as some unexplained long-term cycles of spinning up and spinning down, etc. But that's not even the real problem. The problem is that they're trying to explain the observed spinning up of Bennu with the same YORP effect that Hayabusa 2 team is using to explain the hypothetical spinning down of asteroid Ryugu. It starts to make really little sense from that point. Now, it is true that theoretically, and I repeat theoretically, YORP might indeed lead to both spinning up and spinning down, and that would depend mostly on the shape and orientation of the object. But the thing is that Bennu and Ryugu have almost exactly the same shape. More than that, they have almost the same orientation. Take a look at this picture, for example. Here I've plotted the orbits of inner solar system planets, that is, Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars. On the next picture, I've added Bennu's orbit in darker blue. And on the third picture, I've also added Ryugu's orbit in red. So if I now add here the orientations of their spin axes, you'd immediately understand what I mean. Numerically speaking, their spin axes differ less than 8 degrees, so they're pointing almost in the same spot in the sky. Note also that they are both spinning backwards, just like Venus. Here I've plotted all the other planets' spin axes. So from that I conclude that if YORP is indeed acting upon both of these asteroids, it should follow that it would have the same effect on both of them, and therefore either Hayabusa 2 or OSIRIS-REx team is wrong in interpreting their data, or maybe even both of them. But since we're already looking at orbital diagrams, which I personally enjoy doing, let me note another thing that might not be immediately evident. Both these asteroids essentially at some point of their orbits cross the orbit of Earth. I've indicated these crossings with purple circles. In fact, both these asteroids might potentially impact Earth in the next couple of centuries. And I'm only mentioning this to support my next statement, that in my opinion, the orbits of these objects might indicate that they actually originate from this area of the solar system, and they're not some intruders from the inner asteroid belt. It would only seem logical that if they both originated from the catastrophes that involved, for example, planet Earth and Mars, or maybe Venus too, they wouldn't stray too far from the area where this catastrophe occurred. That would potentially explain why both these asteroids move roughly between Earth and Mars. Even more so, if one looks at the exact arrangement of the orbit of Ryugu, another fascinating thing would surface, that its perihelion is really well aligned with Earth's, if one discards the difference in orbital inclination. The coincidence is quite incredible. Both Earth's and Ryugu's ecliptic longitude of perihelion is 102 degrees. Here I've shown the perihelia positions with thin black lines. Yes, potentially it is possible to explain all of that through some long-term gravitational interactions, tidal forces and resonances and things like that. But remember that first we need to somehow drag these objects here from the inner asteroid belt without them being destroyed or thrown away into the outer system by these gravitational interactions. So maybe it would be reasonable to assume that these alignments are the result of these asteroids being born from some catastrophic processes involving the inner planets in the first place. Maybe not even the Earth, but the Moon, for example, as I've noted that the spin axes of Bennu and Ryugu are almost exactly opposite to the lunar spin axis, depicted with gray arrow in this picture. There's only 4 to 5 degrees difference between them. Okay, let's now return to the issue of the spin rate change. What are the options from the standpoint of electrical excavation of these bodies from planetary crusts? Of course, theoretically here, Yorp effect might also play a role, so that explanation is possible. But at the same time, I wish to repeat the points made in the previous video following from that paper with liquid droplets, that perhaps these objects continue to very slowly relax to a more spherical shape after being squashed by electrical forces during the time of their birth. In this case, as more and more matter moves closer to the spin axis, the angular momentum conservation would dictate that the body should spin faster and faster. If that is true, theoretically, if we'd observe the objects long enough, we would see the very slow shrinking of their equatorial radii in favor of higher latitudes radii. Unfortunately, however, we haven't been able to determine their shape with good enough precision previously. The mean value of ground-based radar observations gives a diameter of Bennu of 492 meters, while OSIRIS-REx shows a 490 meters of diameter. So one could say that indeed the equator is shrinking, but the error bars of the first measurement are so big that they include the second value as possible too. And finally, at the moment, I wouldn't even discount possible electromagnetic effects of spinning up the asteroid, especially if it's at least slightly magnetized. Its interaction with the solar wind plasma might potentially induce a torque that would spin it up or down depending on the field configuration. Now let's discuss the surface properties of these asteroids. One thing that both Hayabusa 2 and OSIRIS-REx teams indicate is the noticeable lack of small craters. They assume that it is the consequence of either the dynamic reshaping of the surface or of the presence of regolith, that is, dust, that would quickly bury them. The problem with that, however, is that both Ryugu and Bennu demonstrate some craters even in the equatorial region, which suggests that their equatorial bulges appeared before subsequent alteration of their surfaces, and the surface hasn't completely relaxed ever since. But researchers themselves acknowledge, especially in case of Ryugu with its hypothetical spinning down, that the equatorial bulges should be really old. So why didn't they also reshape during all these supposed hundreds of millions of years? Large craters also did not relax to the overall shape of their surroundings, and their depth to diameter ratios of about 0.16 are consistent with other asteroids such as Eros and Vesta, which have this parameter of about 0.15, but not in any way represent rubble piles. That seems not really consistent with the rubble pile hypothesis, and perhaps indicates a higher internal strength of the underlying material than what is assumed by the researchers. Conversely, in the electrical scenario, some of the craters might have appeared due to plasma discharges on the surface as it was rebalancing its electric potential after the initial catastrophic event that has led to the formation of the body. So perhaps the deficit of small craters might be explained if one assumes that the strength of the surface is underestimated, so that only really energetic processes would leave craters. And it doesn't really matter if we're talking about discharges or impacts here. It's quite peculiar that asteroid Ryugu has twice more large boulders than asteroid Itokawa per unit of area, but the same number of craters. And in the case of Bennu, the researchers themselves admit that these boulders and their complexity, quote, imply energetic events that far exceed what Bennu can support, end of quote. The researchers actually sometimes start contradicting themselves and state that, I quote, evidence for structural strength includes Bennu's non-hydrostatic shape, the high-standing longitudinal ridges, the long linear grooves, and apparent mass wasting. A fluid-like hydrostatic shape with Bennu's density and rotation rate is not stable, end of quote. So how then is this supposedly rubble pile object exists? Maybe it's not a rubble pile after all? With regards to the regolith, I should note that it seems that there is much less of it than what was assumed. For example, Mascot Lander has found no regolith where it landed on the surface of Ryugu, and the same seems true for the photos from other two landers. It's definitely very rocky out there, but also not very dusty. In fact, OSIRIS-REx's team has been complaining in some of the papers that the abundance of rock and the deficit of pristine, flat, dusty areas might compromise the success of the mission, since initially they, I quote, hypothesized that over time, gravel migration had built up the equatorial ridge that was apparent in the radar-shaped model. Even though the equatorial region is the geopotential low, it is in fact dominated by large concentrations of boulders with little apparent fine-grained regolith. Bennu does not contain the extensive patches of fine-grained regolith according to which we designed the mission, end of quote. Other fascinating find is a relatively low values of thermal inertia, on average 350 for Bennu and 200 to 500 for Ryugu, where the units are joules divided by meter squared divided by Kelvin divided by square root of a second. Compare that to some other similar objects' thermal inertia. For example, asteroid Itokawa has 750, and the lowest thermal inertia documented in a meteorite is 770, in the meteorite called Pockefeld. Basically, thermal inertia is a measure of how hard it is to heat up or cool down a body. So in my opinion, low values of thermal inertia of asteroids Bennu and Ryugu would imply a relatively good heat conduction, and therefore a relatively strong internal structure, at least in the near surface layer, that would allow the heat to be quickly transferred to and from the asteroids. Now, this is not a definite evidence for that per se, as the properties of boulders and even small amounts of dust covering the surface would also play a huge role in the measured value of thermal inertia. But coupled to some other hints that I've mentioned, in my opinion, it provides a more or less coherent picture. Speaking of boulders, Hayabusa 2 team acknowledges that they seem to be internally strong. I quote, the shallower slope in the small size range suggests a non-negligible mechanical strength of individual boulders slash pebbles on Ryugu, end of quote. And also, I quote, the boulders on Ryugu have survived impact processes during catastrophic disruption, the reaccumulation process, and more recent impacts on Ryugu. They are not dust balls with little cohesion, end of quote. So if these boulders are supposed to represent some primordial material and they demonstrate significant internal strength, why is the rest of these asteroids considered to be so weak? Maybe they aren't after all. We'll examine some more evidence for that in the next video and also talk about the recent finding of dust grains in space around Bennu.